Today we're going to look at the Psalms. We're going to start with Psalm 44 and then Psalm 10. Psalm 44 is entitled A Prayer for Protection. With our own ears we have heard it, O God. Our ancestors have told us about it, about the great things that you did in their time, in the days long ago. How you drove out the heathen and established your people in their land. How you punished other nations and caused your own to prosper. Your people did not conquer the land with their swords. They did not win it by their own power. It was by your power and your strength, by the assurance of your presence, which showed that you love them. You are my king and my God. You give victory to your people, and by your enemies we defeat, and by your power we defeat our enemies. I do not trust in my bow or in my sword to save me, but you have saved us from our enemies and defeated those who hate us. We will always praise you and give thanks to you forever. But now you have rejected us and let us be defeated. You no longer march out with our armies. You made us run from our enemies, and they took for themselves what was ours. You allowed us to be slaughtered like sheep. You scattered us in foreign countries. You sold your own people for a small price, as though they had little value. Our neighbors see what you did to us, and they mock us and laugh at us. You have made us an object of contempt among the nations. They shake their heads at us in scorn. I am always in disgrace. I am covered with shame from hearing the sneers and the insults of my enemies and those who hate me. All this has happened to us even though we have not forgotten you or broken the covenant you made with us. We have not been disloyal to you. We have not disobeyed your commands. You left us helpless among wild animals. You abandoned us in deepest darkness. Now, if we had stopped worshipping our God and prayed to a foreign God, you would have surely discovered it, because you know our secret thoughts. But it is on your account that we are being killed all the time, that we are treated like sheep to be slaughtered. Wake up, O Lord. Why are you asleep? Rouse yourself. Don't reject us forever. Why are you hiding from us? Don't forget our suffering and our trouble. We fall crushed to the ground. We lie defeated in the dust. Come to our aid because of your constant love. Save us. And we move back a few pages to Psalm 10. Which is entitled A Prayer for Justice. Why are you so far away, O Lord? Why do you hide yourself when we're in trouble? The wicked are proud and persecute the poor. Catch them in traps that they have made. The wicked are proud of their evil desires. The greedy curse and reject the Lord. The wicked do not care about the Lord. In their pride, they think that God doesn't matter. The wicked succeed in everything. They cannot understand God's judgment. They sneer at their enemies. They say to themselves, I will never fail. I will never be in trouble. Their speech is filled with curses, lies, and threats. They are quick to speak hateful, evil words. They hide themselves in the villages, waiting to murder innocent people. They spy on their helpless victims. They wait in their hiding places like lions. They lie in wait for the poor. They catch them in their traps and drag them away. The helpless victims lie crushed. Brute force has defeated them. The wicked say to themselves, God doesn't care. He has closed his eyes and will never see me. O Lord, punish those wicked people. Remember those who are suffering. How can the wicked despise God and say to themselves, he will not punish me? But you do see, you do take notice of trouble and suffering, and are always ready to help. The helpless commit themselves to you. You have always helped the needy. Break the power of the wicked and the evil people. Punish them for the wrong they have done until they do it no more. The Lord is King forever and ever. Those who worship other gods will vanish from this land. You will listen, O Lord, to the prayers of the lowly. You will give them courage. You will hear the cries of the oppressed and the orphans. You will judge in their favor, so that mortal men may cause terror no more.
Hello and welcome once again to Ilford High Road Baptist Church. If you've just found us for the first time, then special welcome to you, and we hope that you will be encouraged and helped through the readings, the prayers, and the messages in this broadcast. If you come back again, then that's great to see you once again, and pray that the Lord will continue to be near to you and strengthen you through his word. Today we're going to begin a group of just three messages, or at least three initially. Today, just exploring the question, how can we find something of the presence of God in the darkness of grief? And there's a lot of grief and pain at the moment in the strange days in which we are living. And then the following 2 weeks, we will try and explore a little what the Bible has to say to us when we say, does God care? Does God care about our pain and our suffering? So welcome, and we hope that you will find today helpful and a blessing to you. Surgeons and nurses, porters and volunteers, care home staff and bus drivers, and many, many more are among those who sadly have died in recent weeks due to the COVID-19 virus here in the UK. The number include a 13-year-old boy, 35-year-old much-loved and gifted science teacher. They include mothers of young children, grandparents who had much to live for and see the growth of their grandchildren. They include married couples, brothers and sisters. And every single one of them is mourned deeply with many tears by their family, their friends, their neighbours. Sometimes the grief seems too much. It just rolls over us like thick, damp fog. It envelops us in a cold, unyielding darkness. In that darkness, are there any little crumbs of comfort? Is there even the tiniest glimmer of hope anywhere in all the grief? Is there any way of finding God in the darkness of grief? Our Psalms today and the message that I'm bringing to you does, I admit, presuppose that we believe there is a God. And also that we think that in our grief, we do want to find God. We hope that in his presence we'll find a little bit of comfort and peace, even if it doesn't ease the pain immediately. So I invite you to come with me and explore these and other psalms together, and to see, first of all, that the psalms often are seeking for God in their times of trouble. In such moments, of course, we want explanations, and sadly often there aren't very many of them. And the Bible, and particularly the book of Psalms, speak of lament. They offer to us the cries, the anguished cries of men and women as they seek for some answer, some meaning, for God himself even, in their pain and their grief and their darkness. We want to know why. Why did God let this happen? Why didn't God stop it? Why did my loved one have to be those who die? Often there are few answers. Only the loss, the broken hearts, the pain, and the tears. And those of us who have faith in God, we're not shielded or exempt from such moments. And yet in them, somehow we feel that if only we could know something of the Lord's presence, it would at least help, if only a little. And so these psalms help us. They cry out, probably at times literally cry out to the Lord for help, for grace, for some sign of his presence with them. Psalm 5 sounds quite positive in its core. Give ear to my words, O Lord. Listen to my cry, my King. I will direct my prayer to thee and look up. The thought being of looking up expectantly to see what God will do. Psalm 6 begins to sound more urgent, wondering what is happening. Be gracious to me, Lord, for I'm languishing. Oh, Lord, heal me. My bones are shaking with terror. Move on another couple of pages to Psalm 13, and it starts to sound quite desperate. How long, O Lord? Are you going to forget me forever? Psalm 22, simply, my God, why have you forsaken me? And in all of these psalms, do we not hear the voice of men and women crying out to God? Is this not them seeking for God? If only the Lord would answer. If only he would say something. If only he would shed a little light on their suffering and why he permits it. If only he would come to their help in their trouble and pain and tears and darkness. If you've read the book and you know the story of Job, you'll know how he longed for God to answer him. And yet when the Lord finally does speak, he gives no answers to Job at all. In fact, the Lord proceeds to ask him 76 questions, none of which Job has any answer for at all. But come back to the psalm. Some of them begin to find some light at the end of the tunnel. They begin to recover a renewed confidence in God's presence and his help. They don't get an explanation to the why question, but they do find reassurance in their troubles. For example, Psalm 10 that we have just listened to, though it begins so desperately, my God, why have you forsaken us? It ends, the Lord is King. You've heard the desire of the afflicted. You encourage them. You listen to their cry. You defend the fatherless and the oppressed. But that's not true of all of the psalms. Some of them don't find such hope at all. Psalm 89. It begins in praise. I will sing of the Lord's great love forever. But then the psalm writer begins to feel that everything has gone horribly wrong. You've rejected us. You've spurned us. How long, Lord? Are you going to hide forever? There is a final fresh shoot of hope, I admit, right at the end. not in Psalm 88, begins in misery. Lord, I am overwhelmed with my troubles. Lord, you have put me in the lowest pit. You put me in the deepest darkness. I cry to you, but why do you reject me? And it concludes, darkness is even my closest friend. And it's for those reasons that some of the Psalms do not only ask for God to act swiftly, or ask how long before he will answer them, or even ask where God is. They express a fear, a feeling, a despair that actually God is distant and even hiding from them. And at the time when they need him most. Some of the Psalms show us men and women seeking for God in their troubles and the darkness of grief. Then sometimes we see that God seems to hide himself when we're in trouble. That's how Psalm 10 begins. Why are you standing far off, Lord? Why are you hiding yourself in the time of trouble? God seems distant. God seems to have deserted his people in their time of trouble. Maybe many of you have enjoyed a game of peekaboo with a little child, and it's a lot of fun. When they get older, hide and seek, especially if you've got a big house or a garden, is a great game. It's not fun when we're in trouble. It's not fun when we are in grief, and it's not fun when it's God who hides and refuses to be found by us. Of course, God being God, he is present at all places and at all times. Therefore, in reality, is never far from any of us. And even when we speak in awe and wonder of God's presence in heaven, which seems far off to us, it's no barrier to the Lord being near to his people. And so Psalm 73 proclaims, the nearness of God is my good. Psalm 145, the Lord is near to all who call upon him. And in a similar way, Isaiah says, he who vindicates me is near. That's all well and good when things are working out just fine. That's all well and good when the Lord does vindicate us, does help us, does save us, does provide for us. But what when everything's going wrong? What when we feel that deep grief? When the darkness of grief surrounds us and grips us, what then? There are moments when it really does feel that God withdraws his felt presence from us and delays his help. We can't bear it. We wonder why, if God loves us, why on earth is he treating us like this? That's the thought of Psalm 44. It begins on a high note. Lord, we've heard of what you did in the past. And Lord, we've seen with our own eyes your deliverance. Then comes verse 9, begins with the word but. And instantly the whole feel of the psalm suddenly changes. But you rejected us. You humbled us. You no longer go with us. You gave us up. You have sold us. Ouch. Is that how they really feel? Is. And so the psalm begins to ask what God is trying to achieve through their pain and their suffering. It asks why God has brought it upon them, or at the very least allowed it. And the grief, the darkness is all the darker because they don't feel that they deserve it. They hadn't forgotten God. They hadn't turned away to idols. They hadn't strayed from his path. If they'd done any of those things, well, maybe they might understand. But they haven't. And like Job, the people in making that prayer, not claiming to be perfect, just that at that moment, they're not aware of anything in particular that they've done really badly wrong. So they cry to God for help. To all intents and purposes, it seems that God is asleep. That God is actually hiding his face from them. Reality is that it's not so much that God himself hides from us. More that he hides from us the purpose or the reason for what he is doing. I mean, we might not even understand it if he did tell us. But we struggle with it. We struggle with not knowing. We struggle with God not answering. And we feel that he's hiding himself from us. And that only adds to the pain that we feel, the grief that we're going through, and the darkness of the darkness, as it were. Isaiah 45 also speaks of God hiding himself. There the Lord says that he will raise up someone called Cyrus, a foreign ruler. Cyrus will be called the Lord's anointed and will do the Lord's work. And through that foreigner, Israel will be able to return home from exile. We probably don't feel the sense of shock that the Jewish people would have in hearing that. What? A Gentile to do the Lord's work? How on earth could that happen? And a Gentile to be described as the Lord's anointed? That's just impossible. No way! Isaiah says, oh yes, way. This is the Lord's way. A hidden way. A this makes no sense at all kind of way. And so we see that it's God's ways and his actions that are hidden from us, beyond our understanding, which makes us feel that God himself has hidden from us. The reality is that the Lord doesn't forget either his people or their sufferings. And so thirdly, I want to move on this morning and say that God is not only with us, but even shares in our afflictions. How many times does God say to men and women in the scriptures, I will never forget? In Genesis 28, Jacob is in trouble. He's running from his brother. He's on a long journey, and the Lord speaks and says, Jacob, I'm with you. And what's more, I will watch over you, and I will keep you wherever you go. Following the death of Moses, as Joshua begins to lead the people of God, the Lord says to him, Joshua, don't be afraid. As I was with Moses, I will be with you. Joshua has to simply stop and think. He knows how the Lord was with Moses when Moses went to face Pharaoh. When things went from bad to worse. When they reached the Red Sea and there was no getting across it. And when the people grumbled because there was no bread and there was no water. The Bible is full of examples of men and women who find that indeed God is with us in the most difficult times. In the darkness of our grief. Psalm 23 is well known and loved by many. And it begins great. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall lack nothing. It speaks of green pastures and still waters. Life is good. David knows there are tough times, painful times. Even the valley of the shadow And at that point, what does he say? You are with me. You are with me. And yet, as other psalms show us, there were many times when the people didn't know or enjoy the presence of the Lord quite like that in their dark times. But maybe we don't either sometimes. What can we do? Let me encourage you to allow others to journey with you. If you find yourself in that place of deep darkness, allow someone just to read the scriptures to you. Allow them to pray with you, to speak the words for you. Allow them to help you little by little learn to trust the promise that the Lord is with us and he won't leave us or abandon us, no matter how much we feel that he has. But not only is the Lord with us in our griefs, he shares them with us. I recommend to you some words from Isaiah 63, verses 7 to 9. And here the prophet Isaiah praises God for his kindnesses, for the many good things that he has done for the people. And then verse 9 says that in all their distress, he too was distressed. The older authorized version says, in all their afflictions, he too was afflicted. Now, what are we going to make of those words? Brings us into an area of theology over which there's been a lot of discussion for 40, 50 years. The doctrine of the impassibility of God. That God is not subject to suffering or involuntary passions in the same way that we are. Perhaps for today we can leave the debates aside so that we don't miss the jewel that is here. We know that when the Bible speaks of God's eyes, God's ears, God's hands, it's saying something quite different than when we use those words of human people. And similarly, when the Bible speaks about God's emotions, it's saying something that is not the same as when we use those words to describe people. One way we must be careful not to think that God is subject to emotions in the same way that we are. What I mean by that is our emotions are infected by sin. So they're often fickle and at times they rule us, but not so with God. But we must not so emphasize that we miss that priceless jewel that God sets before us here in these words. A real treasure to hold on to in the darkness of grief. Perhaps it is the older translation that is preferable. In their afflictions, he too was afflicted. Because the word distress sounds as if God is suffering anguish and torment and is inconsolable. And God's not distressed in quite that way. God is not in a position where he doesn't know what to do next. In fact, Isaiah 63 shows us all the things that God does do. Because in their afflictions, he was afflicted. And that's why he redeemed them. That's why he lifted them up. That's why he carried them. One of the great reformers, Calvin, puts it like this. He says, when the Bible uses words like this, God is using language that is limited to our ability so that we can understand something. So one to encourage you today to just take hold of these words. In all their affliction, he too was afflicted. Hold them in your hands, as it were, and look at them. When Israel were slaves in Egypt, God saw their suffering. God heard their cries of pain. And God felt the darkness of their grief. And God cared. He showed that care in his many kindnesses to them, the way that he helped them. Not immediately, but in his time. We don't know why, and God has not seen fit to explain it to us, but he cared very deeply. In all of their afflictions, he too was afflicted. And as you hold those words and look at them, remember that the Lord is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And so he still shares with us in our pains and our grief. What are you feeling today? Is there loss of one kind or another? I mean, often when we hear that word, we think immediately of death. The death of a parent. The death of a husband or wife. Maybe perhaps a child in pregnancy or childhood. But there can also be the loss of relationship when someone begins to suffer from dementia. There can be the loss of work, the loss of a dream. There can be the sudden loss caused by an accident or other trauma. There can be the loss of health through a stroke or a heart attack. And every kind of loss brings pain, heartache, tears. And at times that loss seems to surround us like a dark cloud. So again, let me urge you, hold these words in front of you. In all their afflictions, he too was afflicted. And now say it to yourself, maybe out loud even, in all my affliction, he too is afflicted. The Lord is there, beside you, with you in the darkest valley, even if you can't feel that right now. He is. He won't give up on you. He won't abandon you. Loss and the grief that it brings can be devastating. It can feel as if all is thick darkness around us. It can seem like the Lord doesn't hear our cries, and the Psalms, they understand that. It can seem as if the Lord is distant, even trying to hide from us, and again, Scripture understands that too. Even when we find no answer to the question, why? And when grief threatens to overwhelm us, the Lord is still near. Why doesn't he end all suffering and grief right now? I don't know the answer to that. But I do know that one day he will. And I do know that in the meantime, the Lord will always be with you. And in all of your afflictions, he will be afflicted. In the darkness of grief, he is there. Just that often we can't see how. But he is. And he feels for you. Let him be near. Let his promises bring peace to your mind and soothe your fears. And remember, in all your afflictions, he too is afflicted. Let us pray together.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we want to come to a God that we call Father. We want to thank you for your love. We want to thank you for your care. We want to thank you that we mean that much to you, that you would know about our every moment of every day. We want to thank you that you are a God that allows us to come back into your presence. And whether we're angry or whether we're singing your praises, you hear us and you welcome our presence. Father, we want to thank you that you are a God that shares our suffering. We want to thank you that you are a God of justice and righteousness. And we want to thank you that you are a sovereign God. And so your righteousness and your justice will indeed prevail. Father, we want to thank you that your very nature is one of love and compassion. We want to thank you that you know exactly what it's like. Your son came, he lived, he was rejected, he was despised, he was crucified. Father, you know what moments of despair feel like. You know what suffering feels like. You know that sometimes through that we cannot and do not see your presence. Father, we want to thank you that you are a God that can be known. We want to thank you that you are a God that as we look back across our lives, we can see your hand guiding, guarding, bringing us safely through. We want to thank you that you are a God that we can have a personal relationship with. And so, Father, at this time when we come into your presence, we want to ask that you be very real and very present for those that are suffering at this time, those who have lost their loved ones and are still grieving, those for whom lockdown has brought depression and anxiety, for those who each day put the health and welfare of others before their own safety and go home not knowing whether they have been infected or not. Father, we would pray for them. We would pray that they might know your peace, they might know your comfort, that you might be as close to them as their closest friend. Father, we want to pray for the chaplains and the care home workers, those that indeed have the very discussions that we've had this morning. Where is God in my time of distress? Why can I not see his face? Father, we would pray for those that have that conversation, that indeed we may all have the confidence that you are a God who never changes his mind, who when he says he loves us, means he loves us all of the time. When he says that he will be with us through the dark valleys, the shadows of death, the difficult times as well as the easy times. We have a God who is there. And we want to thank you for that. But we want others to know that presence, that very real presence that you bring. For a faith that sustains in the difficult times. For faith that believes in your word when our own human instincts seem to be such at odds to it. Father, we would pray for our world, for it is not just us and it is not just our loved ones and it's not just our work colleagues that are suffering. We recognize that this indeed is a pandemic that we're living through. We want to thank you that we can see countries safely coming out the other end. But Father, we want to pray for their politicians. We want to pray for our politicians, that indeed they might make wise decisions at this time. And Father, we would indeed pray for our politicians, for we recognize that this is not the only issue that they are wrestling with. And Father, we would pray particularly for the politicians in the USA at the moment who are having to find a way of saying that all lives matter. Father, we thank you that in your eyes, all lives matter. From conception to death, regardless of race, colour, regardless of professional qualifications, regardless of economic position, regardless of contribution that we may or may not be making to our society. We want to thank you that your word assures us that all lives matter. And Father, we would want to pray for all those that have to make decisions at this time, how we respond to indeed another worldwide call to recognize that within every society of our land and lands across the world. Father, we would pray for our politicians, for we recognize that the day-to-day decisions still have to be made. And we recognize that the decisions they make could either draw our society nearer to you or take it further away. And so, Father, we would ask your hand upon all of those within public service, but particularly those that determine our laws, that indeed you might grant them wisdom, that you might grant them courage to stand by the truths of your word, that they might lead our lands closer to you and not further from you. Amen.